Chancellor, Mr. Vice Chancellor, Professor Robertson, Mr. Diamond, Mr. Daniel, ladies and gentlemen, I come here this evening because of my deep interest and affection for a land settled by the Dutch in the mid-17th century, then taken over by the British and lost independence. Land in which the native inhabitants were at first subdued, relations with whom remain a problem to this day. A land which defined itself on a hostile frontier. A land which attained rich natural resources through the energetic application of modern technology. A land which was once the importer of slaves, and now must struggle to wipe out the last traces of that form of bondage. I refer, of course, to the United States of America. We stand here in the name of freedom, at the heart of that Western freedom and democracy, with the belief that the individual man, the child of God, touchstone of values in all societies, all groups and states exist for that person's benefit. Therefore, the enlargement of liberty for individual human beings must be the supreme goal and the abiding practice of any Western society. The first element of this individual liberty is the freedom of speech, the right to express and communicate ideas. Set aside oneself apart from the dumb beasts of fields and forests. The right to recall governments to their duties and to their obligations. Above all, the right to affirm one's membership and allegiance to the body politic, society, to the men with whom we share our land, our heritage, and our children's future. Hand in hand with freedom of speech, power to be heard, to share in the decisions of government which shape men's lives. Everything that makes man's life worthwhile, family, work, education, a place to rear one's children, and a place to rest one's head, all this depends on the decisions of government. All can be swept away by a government which does not heed the demands of its people. I mean all of it. Therefore, the essential humanity of man can be protected and preserved only where government must end, not just to the wealthy, not just to those of a particular religion, not just to those of a particular race, but to all the people. And even government, by the consent of the governed, in our own constitution, must be limited in its power to act against its people, so that there may be no interference with the right to worship, but also no interference with the security of the home. No arbitrary imposition of pain or penalty on an ordinary citizen by officials high or low. No restriction on the freedom of men of any kind, so that each man may become all that he is capable of becoming. These are the sacred rights of Western society. These were the essential differences between us and Nazi Germany, as they were between Athens and Persia. They are the essence of our differences. Thank you. Many nations have set forth their own definitions and declarations of these principles, and there have often been wide and tragic gaps between promise and performance, ideal and reality. Yet the great ideals have constantly recalled us to our own duties. And with painful slowness, we in the United States have extended and enlarged the meaning and the practice of freedom to all of our people. For two centuries, my own country has struggled to overcome the self-imposed handicaps of prejudice and discrimination based on nationality, social class, or race. Discrimination profoundly repugnant to the theory and the command of our Constitution. Even as my father grew up in Boston, Massachusetts, signs told him, no Irish need apply. Two generations later, President Kennedy became the first Irish Catholic and the first Catholic to head the nation. But how many men of ability had before 1961 been denied the opportunity to contribute to the nation's progress because they were Catholic or because they were of Irish extraction? How many sons of Italian or Jewish or Polish parents slumbered in the slums, untaught, unlearned, their potential lost forever to our nation and to the human race? Even today, what price will we pay before we have assured full opportunity to millions of Negro Americans? In the last 5 years, we have done more to assure equality to our Negro citizens and to help the deprived, both white and black, than in the 100 years before that time. But much, much more remains to be done. For there are millions of Negroes untrained for the simplest of jobs, and thousands every day denied their full and equal rights under the law. And the violence of the disinherited, the insulted, the injured, looms over the streets of Harlem and of Watts, just outside Chicago. But a Negro American trains now as an astronaut, one of mankind's first explorers into outer space. Another is the chief barrister of the United States government and doesn't sit on the benches of our court. And another, Dr. Martin Luther King, is the second man of African descent win the Nobel Peace Prize for his nonviolent efforts for social justice between all of the races. We have passed laws prohibiting